Hello, my name is Shane Young, and welcome to the Todd Quint SharePoint podcast number 328, recorded live, that's right, not dead, February 20th, 2017. I'm your host, Shane Young, and with me today is the guy who is now unemployed and now too lazy to do anything, even, won't even do the show intro anymore, that's how bad it's gotten, Mr. Todd Quint.
Yo, yeah, I don't think all of you out in podcast listener land understand how much work I go into every week doing the intro. I have to copy it from the previous week's notes and paste it into the current week's notes. I've just been swamped lately. And we've got a thing in the notes where Shane's going to make fun of me about my unemployed life. But if you want to send me notes of, pick-me-ups or whatever, you can email me todd@toddclint.com, and I'll be there, and I'll try to reply back, all that. Hit me on the web, toddclint.com.
So let me help out here, right? Because most of our listeners are just listeners. They don't get this beautiful picture that I've got right now. So let me paint you guys a picture. Imagine Mr. Quint in a hideous $12 Kmart bathrobe with a white stained t-shirt on underneath it. Right? Yeah, there you go.
It's sort of stained. Does barbecue sauce count as a stain? I can't remember.
If you can lick it and still get flavor, I don't think it counts as a stain. If the flavor's gone, it's a stain.
Let's find out.
So his hair's all ruffled, but his hair always looks bad anyway, so it's hard to tell if it's better or worse than usual. Looks like we've got 1, 2, 3 empty boxes of Girl Scout cookies behind him, where there used to be a work computer. There's no longer work computers. Now there's Girl Scout cookies.
This is work. These Thin Mints do not eat themselves. We've got a couple fallen soldiers here.
Now, you do understand that Thin Mint is not going to make you thin, right? The freshman 15 and the unemployed 15 are the same thing, so just be careful.
Is that true? I thought they made you thin. I thought that's why they called. If you can't trust Girl Scouts, who can you trust?
It's kind of like the media these days. There's just no one you can believe anymore.
There's no one you can trust. Huh?
So, yeah, I mean, I don't know. Todd, can you cover any production notes? Is that too much to ask? Or are we still just kind of not doing any work?
Well, the production notes are everything is produced. And I had last week 327. That thing's been out for, man, going on 40 minutes now. I mean, it has been out on the internet for nearly an hour. I mean, we could almost round up to an hour. I think production's fine.
Yeah, I mean, the CDNs are almost ready to start streaming it out to the thousands of listeners that we have that enjoy my wonderful voice and your charming great looks. It does look like you still managed to brush your teeth today, though. I don't see any food in your teeth, so that's good.
No, I haven't eaten. Just the cookies, but they lick them clean. You don't want to waste any of that. Yeah.
Gotcha. Well, so speaking of eating, I hear that you went to lunch with your kid today. I guess your kid's on the free lunch program, so you thought you could go and get a free lunch, but that didn't work out.
That was the plan. Yeah. So my kids now, my 6-year-old daughter, she has my exuberance and lack of social skills. So the day after I was laid off, she ran to school and told everybody she could that daddy got fired. That was awesome.
Love that kid.
I've been on the, so my oldest daughter's been at that school for 4 years. I've been on the PTO there for 4 years. I know all these teachers and the principal and all the, yeah, my daughter's running around, daddy got fired. So that is awesome. I appreciate that. She's like, you got no excuse not to have lunch with me. So I rolled up to the school today and I looked at the menu, and while I have the palate of roughly a 5-year-old, which, you know, that's, I'm preaching the choir here.
I'm with you.
Yeah. The thing on the menu today did not necessarily inspire confidence in me. So I decided to pack a lunch, and I'm making sandwiches and getting chips. And I realized I don't have a lunchbox because I've worked from home for, 8-9 years.
And most adults don't have a lunchbox. Let's be clear. Most adults don't have a lunchbox.
like a Knight Rider lunchbox and none of that. You guys, I'll be damned. Huh? So anyway, all I could find was my daughter Lily's Hello Kitty lunchbox. So I did it with style. I had my sandwich in there. So I come walking into my daughter's classroom, and all the kids are, I'm holding my Hello Kitty lunchbox. I'm loud. I'm proud. And they were all very confused. One of the boys, he was looking at, and you could tell like he wanted to ask, but he wasn't sure. And I'm like, boys can like Hello Kitty. There's nothing wrong with Hello Kitty. Is there any kitties you like better than Hello Kitty? You can, boys can. I don't think they were on board with that.
Were you trying to start like some type of, fight over the Hello Kitty versus Garfield, right? The battle of the cats.
That's not bad. I should have done that. I did try to start a food fight, but apparently first graders really don't get into that like they did when I was a kid. I don't remember that. But no, I was and so the other thing, I'm standing in line, I got my lunch bag, and I'm just following my daughter around. And you know, so I was telling kids, I'm like, I'm a transfer student from across town. I'm a little slow. I had to retake the first grade a couple of times, but I think I got it this time. I feel very confident.
Should have made some Madison jokes. It just went right.
I got the Trans Am. Billy Madison had a Trans Am.
I know.
Yep. Could do the shampoo and conditioner song. But I did do the thing that you always want to do when you come to a new place. I found the biggest kid in the grade, and I went right over to him. I'm like, I know you're used to running this place, kid, but now there's a new sheriff in town. So I'll be taking, half a year of candy, or else there's going to be trouble.
See, if that kid just stomped on your tool and said, "Oh, Doyle rules," it would have been the greatest moment of my life.
So it was, it was a good, time. So I got to do that and, got to embarrass that daughter, and then just worked out that the other daughter's lunch thing came through. So I went and got in line with her and embarrassed her in front of her friends.
Good to hear.
Good day.
So
good
I'm
use
glad
of
to
unemployment.
See, yeah. You're keeping up. You're getting out of the house more than you did when you worked at Rackspace, but we won't figure any of that out. So glad to see you're still rolling along and doing your thing.
Yeah. Yeah. And so, yeah, you can tell I'm like not really getting dressed much or anything like that. The thing is, you get dressed and then you just got to get undressed and you shower. And the next thing you know, you're dirty again. I mean, this is all just incredibly wasteful. I'm trying to do my part. And so I just don't. Seems like.
If you could use this time to become a tree hugger, that would be wonderful for me. If you could start telling me about the environment, save the whales and pipelines going through places I don't even know anything that it's about, but if you could start those type of comments, I would really appreciate it.
I could do that. So the unemployment thing has definitely added a new aspect of things. So my wife and I went to Miami over the weekend. She had a work thing, and I went as arm candy. So it was me and the other work wives hanging out by the pool, you know, going for runs, things like that. And Saturday, after all of our work stuff was done, we went down to South Beach and went shopping. And so I ran into one of her coworkers. She was in a store, clothes shopping or whatever. And I ran into one of her coworkers and his girlfriend. And he's like, "Where's she at?" I'm like, "Well, she's in a store. She's shopping." He's like, "You left her alone, unsupervised?" And I'm like, "Dude, I got no job. I can't be telling her how to spend money. I don't have that kind of leverage. I'm just lucky she lets me hang out, keeps buying me food." It's
Did she go in and like check out Versace? Oh, wait, no, sorry, I'm reading it wrong. Versace and all these fun places.
I don't know where she went. So that's one of the things I do. I try not to hover. I just go find some place to, sleep or sit down or, I didn't have my cup with me, so I couldn't panhandle.
You should have. So while you're there, right? So Mark Crispin's going to come on today, right? He's from New York, and he wanted to talk about Office 365 licensing for mobsters and all the problems they're having. He might be able to kind of help you in facilitating. You're finding something to do with your time. It might not be the most ethical thing. It depends on how you feel about, killing kids and stuff like that. But
I can't be choosy. I got no paychecks. I got to do it.
Yeah. All right. So, we'll bring Mark on a little later. Maybe he'll tell you some of the different job options that are out there.
That's good. So what have you been doing?
Well, like you, I also don't really have a job. But I still know how to get dressed. The nice thing for me is I never got dressed nicely when I had a job. So this transition, there was really no – you can't visually tell on me whether or not I have a job or not. But I went today and I went and saw the Lego Batman movie.
How was that?
It was interesting. I want to be respectful, like with Star Wars, yep. Right? We don't want any spoilers. But at the same time, it's a kid's movie. And, if you can't figure out that when – the bad guy goes to do this thing, that Batman's going to stop him. If you can't figure that out going in – probably not for you.
I agree with you, but and again, no spoilers. But in the first Lego movie, there very much was a thing that you could spoil. I mean, there were parts of that you could ruin. So.
And so one of my complaints is that there is nothing like that in the movie that I can spoil.
Oh, that's too bad. That's too bad.
The other interesting thing about it, it was really intense. It was like action, like the whole time. There was almost no slowing down. But in there, they made a lot of references to like the whole life cycle of Batman. So there was, vintage Batman jokes, and there was current Batman jokes, and there was 90s Batman jokes. And I really felt like for my kids that were there with me, right? Because I took the, 4 and 7 year old, and it's like they're missing like 2/3 of this, right? They just see things blowing up and Lego stuff being built, but the movie was almost too complex. I don't know.
How did they feel about it though?
Well, they liked it, right? Because it was just exploding stuff over and over and over again. Batman made some inappropriate jokes about his underwear and, you know, things like that.
Can't go wrong with underwear jokes. So that's one thing I've noticed since I've had kids is they just don't pick up on stuff. Like, they look for different things. And that's why little kids can watch the same movie 1,000 times because they just don't pick it all up at once.
Yeah.
And so they learn new things every time. So, yeah, all the things that, you know, these references that you were getting that you were thinking about, they probably didn't even realize.
Oh, yeah, definitely didn't get them. I also was kind of interesting was so there was a preview before it for a movie called Boss Baby. B-O-S-S Baby.
Yes. I've seen that preview.
That looks hilarious.
I don't know. That one is not caught with me. My kids want to see it something fierce.
Oh, see, I don't know. I mean, little kids or little babies doing inappropriate things. I thought it looked hilarious. So I'm looking forward to seeing that one.
Yeah, I'll get drugged to that one. Well, that's good. So after I'm done embarrassing all of my kids at their school, maybe this week I'll go to a matinee and see, you know, Batman movie, hide out in the theater, maybe go catch John Wick 2, see what else is going on. Maybe some rom-coms if they're out. Well,
I hope you get arrested for theater hopping. That would be just perfect. I mean, oh, yeah, I'll come bail you out. It'd take me about 2 weeks to drive there, but don't you worry. I'll be there.
Yeah, that would be awesome if next week it's just Shane because I'm in the Story County Pokey over here for stealing a movie.
Yeah, well, as long as you're back by March 20th. I mean, that's an important week for us.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So what do we got planned for that?
Yep, so this is everybody's first news. We kind of hinted last week. We're going to run a Todd and Shane show for SharePoint 2013 and 2016 admin class.
Uh-huh.
Getting the band back together for 5 fun-filled days of us teaching some people SharePoint and telling really bad jokes online. It should be spectacular. I don't know.
And it is, I was trying to think how long it's been since you and I taught a class together, but man, it's been like 4 years.
Yeah. Did we teach a full class Iraq?
We did, because if you remember, we were in San Antonio and my wife called me and told me she had to put her cat to sleep. I had to walk out of class so she could tell me she just killed my cat.
Yeah, you know, you had more. It was fine.
Yeah, they're free. Just go to anybody's farm and just snag one.
Yeah, I do. So, yes, that was about 4 years ago. So that was the last time we did it. But, you know, I can't wait to do it. It's kind of when I was describing it today. I was like, there's just so much pent-up energy of really just us bantering for 5 straight days on various SharePoint topics. I can't wait to do it. So,
yeah, it's going to be a good time. Shane shot me this idea shortly after my work situation changed. And I'm like, God, you are insane. There's no way. But I'm like, yeah, I kind of miss it. So, if you want to sign up for that, go to boldzebras.com. And up the top, there's training. Or you can go directly to it. I don't have the URL here handy.
SharePoint Administrator Training. Or it's linked in the show notes that I put together because you couldn't be bothered to do any show notes either.
I don't do show notes.
I wasn't even going to complain about that, but since you pointed it out.
Since I brought it up. That's going to be a good time. And we're going to cover SharePoint 2013, SharePoint 2016, and all of the hybrid-y, goodness-y things that you can do with Office 365.
Yeah, we'll probably get sidetracked on PowerShell a little bit, on talk about some Azure-y stuff, some Office 365 stuff, right? Pretty much paint the whole Microsoft Cloud picture. You guys, if you've listened to the show for more than 5 minutes, you know that we kind of get random off on a tangent. So,
oh, yeah.
If you sign up for the class, that should be your plan. It's like, what tangent can I get the guys off on today?
It's like two squirrels teaching a class and just everybody. And I've talked about this for a long time, that to be a SharePoint admin, you had to know DNS, you had to know Windows, you had to know IIS, you had to know all these things, SQL. And now that is just getting bigger and bigger. That is, nothing has changed. It's just that circle. We just have to have our fingers everywhere.
Yeah. Yeah. And Blake's in the chat room today, right? He was one of our people. He took it one of the last SharePoint 911 classes that we did, right? We had like 25 people or something that week. That was a great class.
That was a good one out there in Cincinnati. Just at Ignite here a couple months ago, I ran into Cedric, who was in one of our classes in Tampa. That was long. I think that was pre-SharePoint 911 days even. I think I was still with Solonite then. That was a long time ago. Yeah. That was before SharePoint 2010 came out. Because I remember you and I at our breaks trying to figure out how we're going to do the SharePoint 2010 class because the requirements are crazy. Like one server needs like 4 gig of RAM. How are we going to do all this?
Yeah, well, I think that was the cycle that I ran I ran Windows Server for my laptop OS so I could run Hyper-V locally for that whole cycle because the hardware hadn't caught up far enough to do it from a desktop OS.
Yep. And not to change the subject, but I'm going to. I see Ross in the chat room. Ross, Shane has sent me the book that he's going to, that I'm going to sign. So it's just waiting for me to find time in my day. I've been swamped. That couch out there in the next room, it gets so lonely and it gets weepy. And that TV just requires me to watch it.
Yeah. And Ross, remember, I wrote nice things in there, but Todd got the book second. So he probably cut the page out. You'd be like, why didn't Shane sign it? Because Todd ripped the page out. So just know.
Yep. So, and
sorry, look at which one were we going to know Ross from?
Atlanta 2011. I remember that one. Yeah.
Right. That was governance, wasn't it?
No, governance was LA 2009, I think.
Oh, I thought so. So was Ross the one where the shoe throwing incident? Is that Ross's?
I don't remember the shoe. And the shoe throwing incident, for those of you who haven't sat through a class with us, Shane threw a shoe at me, or I threw a shoe at. I can't. Was that the one I kicked you out?
Yes,
I kicked you out of one. I got mad at you and kicked you out of class. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so Ross, as you're listening there, what stupid thing did we do in that class? I'm certain that one of our epic, inappropriate, no responsible adults teaching and training class would ever do it. Things happen. I just don't know which one it was there.
Yeah, and the LA one, there's a hysterical story about that we can't tell on a family-friendly podcast about the pre-day conference and one of the attendees.
Just know that you should always fund the mental health levies in your county or state if they come up, because she needed it.
If we ever do a Todd and Shane After Dark, that will be one of the stories that we have to tell, because that's one of the favorites. So we lose you in like 12 minutes, bud, because you got a house full of people waiting for you. And we haven't talked about a single thing, SharePoint or Office 365. So go ahead and take the first one there.
All right. So one of our longtime show viewers, Bill Bear, I think you guys have heard of him before. Last week, he posted a blog post on an overview of conditional access policies with SharePoint Online and OneDrive for Business. We've talked about it a couple of different times ourselves, right? We announced back in January when it released in the Fast Ring. And I don't know, Bill never directly said it, but I felt like his post was kind of like saying, hey, this feature's coming out for the masses. I don't know.
Yeah.
Did you find that in there? I couldn't find those actual words in there, but I felt like that's what he meant to say.
And he kind of hinted around it. He's like, well, we announced this for first release in January, but didn't, I don't think, it come through. Yeah. So this is this idea that you can control who can get to your Office 365 tenant by what network they're connecting from. So this gives you the ability to say only people that are inside of my corporate network can do it. Only people that are, you know, whatever, just another layer of security. Not going to keep all the bad guys out, but it will reduce some of the crimes of opportunity, I guess is a good way to put that.
Yeah, and I'd like to remind you also the point, right, that we used to think of our network security had started at the firewall, right? Because we kind of controlled everything at the firewall. But now with everyone on their mobile phones and their tablets and, you know, getting at it from Starbucks and all that, really your, you know, entry points are way out there in the field. It's not behind your corporate firewall anymore. And you got to think about that. That's where something like this really makes a big difference.
Yeah, and having traveled a bunch, obviously, but traveled over the weekend and hitting hotel hotspots and, you know, random things while I was in Miami, it definitely makes you think about that because just anybody can be poking into that traffic, so you got to be very careful.
Yeah, well, and speaking of how secure that Office 365 and Azure are, is, whatever the right
was,
word was,
could will be, yep.
They just announced that they've gained DoD level 5 PA access or certification or I literally don't know what any of the words mean, but I know that it's not level 4. I know it's not level 6. It's definitely level 5. But other than that,
we agree on that. Yeah. So this is just one of the things that the cloud, Office 365 and everybody else is in the cloud, has had to deal with is security. And they've done a bang up job with that. But then also the other pieces, the higher level security folks, banks and our United States government. And so Microsoft has always had a pretty loud option there. So they had FedRAMP, which is the risk and authorization management program. And they've got some, you know, they've got specific federal government versions of the software. So when we teach classes on Azure and Office 365, we always have to ask if there's any federal tenants in there because they don't get all these things because of security, things like that. And so this is just another one of another feather in Microsoft's cap for our stuff is so secure that the federal government can use it for, and they specifically call it that can handle controlled unclassified information. So not classified, but controlled. There's all these different levels of stuff. And so just another thing, if you're worried about, you know, your stuff not being safe in Office 365 or Azure, it's one less thing to worry about.
I wonder where my social security number falls, right? Is it secured, uncontrolled?
Everywhere. It's in IRC chat rooms that I hang out in and all that. So Blake is asking if you can use a CAC card to log into Office 365. Let me say one thing. I hate CAC card because it's controlled access card. But anyway, so it's something that military folks have. It's the, you know, they log in with that. I've never used specifically a CAC, but since Office 365 can do Federation and all that, I assume you could bolt CAC or anything else into that. But I've never done CAC specifically.
Uh-oh. Blake's coming back at you. You better move on before he gets you.
Yeah, he's going to. Yep. So Blake and I are both in the Army. Not together, but we both. So not to be outdone with the DoD level 5, and they do call out level 4 as being less than level 5 in this thing. So we are one up on those folks using level 4.
Yeah.
So last month, I think, or the month before, Microsoft announced some new improvements to SharePoint document library, some admin stuff, management things about being able to easily move files from one site collection to another, from site collections to, or from team sites to OneDrive for Business and back and forth and all that, which is kind of cheating because, like we've always told people, your My Site is just, you know, it's the team site type thing. It's just the site collection. But now they've added some additional stuff on top of that. So the previous stuff that they had had a 50 megabyte limit. So if you had any, you know, videos of your dog tearing up the couch or whatever, if it was over 50 megabytes, you couldn't use this API to do that. And now it's 500 megabytes. So that's awesome. The other thing is they directly support copy and place. So I can say, you don't have to copy this resume to another site collection. I can copy it in the same place and it'll just call it resume one. So I can start using it for templates and things like that. And the other thing that it does, which is super cool, is you can pick a bunch of files and say download and it will zip them up and you can download a single zip file now. So that's good.
And it's interesting, right? A lot of people, and I guess this is just goes to prove that Office 365 and SharePoint Online is becoming more prevalent, but we are starting to see more requests for things like, hey, I need automated solutions for moving stuff from this document library to this document library, from this document library to OneDrive, right? There's a lot of those type of requests that are now showing up that, you know,
yeah.
6 months or a year ago, we were like, oh, just get your stuff out there, you know? Now they've done
it. In the rare incident where somebody would actually ask about that because nobody was doing it and nobody cared, there were not any great tools, but now it's getting better and better. So I've got a couple of projects. I haven't talked to you about any, but a couple of little PowerShell ideas that I've got around some of this, how to use some of this new stuff that I think people will like. So
we should definitely compare notes. So one of the videos I did was around moving list items based on metadata fields from one list to another. So that's been pretty popular. And a guy asked me the other day, said, hey, I want to do the same thing, but with documents and document libraries. And I'm like, you know, here's the outline of how you do it. But I haven't went and solved all the commandlets of, you know, how do you find and assign this to that? Yeah. And so, yeah, it's actually on my very short list of things to do. So,
yep. So when I get up tomorrow morning,
noon,
10:30, 11. Yeah. Yeah. Noon your time, 11 my time.
Well, fair.
We'll do that. But there's just, as we've said, there's that constant drum of innovation with SharePoint Online and Office 365. And this is just another example.
Yeah.
Another thing that we talk about all the time is how much we love the patterns and practices PowerShell commandlets. And we've been preaching those things for a couple of years now, but they've gone mainstream. They're a big deal now.
Yeah. They've just uploaded them. They uploaded all the documentation for them out to MSDN finally. And yay team. So hopefully they also, as part of doing that, they also updated the help files. A lot of them didn't have actual help with them. And so it looks like they've all got examples now. I did see one of them. It had 9 examples. And I swear to you, 7 of the examples were the same thing. I was like, good job. You got examples, but 7 of the 9 are the same. So
Yeah, and we've said that since the SharePoint 2010 days. You know, every PowerShell commandlet has to have an example, but apparently nobody said that it actually has to work or be helpful, but it does have to be there. And so, yeah, there's been a couple of patterns of practice in ones, but I'll give it to them. That's good stuff.
It is good stuff, right? And I just always assume, right, that poor little intern's just sitting there trying to type and make up stuff. And oh, I don't know if I can tell that story.
Yeah, better, yeah.
I have a great story. So, okay, I can remove the context. So someone I know just took a job at a company full of youngins. And so she needed something updated. So she said, please update this text in this particular part of the product. And so they 5 minutes later, I said, hey, I've got it done. So she went and looked, and it literally said, please update this text in this part of the product, and then the text she wanted. They didn't have enough context to be like, oh, you know, she doesn't want the part where she's explaining it. She just wants this text. Blew my mind that someone could be that mechanical. But I guess when you get to that, you know, intern level, it happens. So,
yeah. So the good news about that story is I've got a friend who owns a local web programming company here and makes websites and all that. And he's offered me a position as an intern. And so he's one of these guys. We have lunch here, you know, a couple times a month, three times a month. And I always try to find some way to make him pay for lunch. Like I've done the whole, oh, I forgot my wallet. So it's just kind of this running gag. And I'm like, so I assume this interim job comes with lunch, company lunch every day. So now I know that I can just, you know, I can just be a dunce and all that.
Yeah. He says, make these changes. Make sure you copy in the email header and footer and everything right in there.
He would love that.
What else we got?
Give yourself some props. That was a good blog post. Go ahead.
So then I was just going to say, I got it published out on Petri, you know, speaking of all this fun stuff. Remember last week we talked about the PowerShell and the passwords and all that. So now it's in text form. So if you prefer to read instead of watch a video of me doing that stuff, along with a video for installing patterns and practice stuff, right? So much video content these days. Well, Todd, when are you going to shower so you can start making videos for these fine folks?
I should do that. Yeah, I should do that. I'm trying to save money. Soap is expensive. Shampoo is expensive.
Internet bandwidth is apparently cheap.
Yeah. That's where I get all my cat videos. That's what helps soothe me at night.
Gotcha. Well, then you guys have got corn, too. You need to come up with a corn-based product, right? That stuff's just growing out in your backyard, your side yard.
I did have some deer in my backyard last week, and deer sound very cute and all that, but deer are big, scary, erratic animals. And all, so I have a walkout basement, and the whole south side of my house where my backyard is windows. So I'm like, oh, cool, deer. And I'm like, oh my God, there is literally no place on this floor where I can hide that if that deer doesn't want to kill me, he can't just run through a window and gut me like a fish. So I started taking pictures, and then they started looking at me, and they outnumbered me 3-1, and they outweighed me, you know, 10-1. And so I went upstairs. I was scared.
You know, most of us, right, because I live in Deerfield Township, right? I have a lot of deer in my yard.
You got good cred there.
And, yeah. You know, we enjoy looking at the deer, the turkeys, you know. I've never once thought, man, this deer might run through my windows because I also have a lot of windows. And
you do.
Kill me. I've never
I never thought about that either until it happened to somebody that I know. The deer ran through, so they had like patio doors on the outside, and it was big, and the deer freaked out and just bolted in their house and got stuck in their house and blood everywhere because it obviously cut itself. I thought they were smarter than that.
Well, so speaking of bolting through doors, my horse, you know, aka Chewy, who weighs 86.5 pounds at 10 months old.
Seen the picture, yep.
Me and Bill Bear are having a contest as to who has a bigger dog, but that's for Facebook.
William the Conqueror is a large dog, yes.
Yeah, I have no doubt that William the Excellent.
William the Excellent, yes.
William the Excellent will be bigger than Chewy, but Chewy's, I think, a month older than him. So right now it's back and forth. But today, it's 65 out here today. I have no idea why. And we opened all the windows. We had the screen door open. My horse plowed right through it, well, right into that screen door, bent the metal frame in half. The meshing never came out of that stuff as industrial strength. Doors now does, you know, kind of this number, but that darn horse.
That's so related funny story about that. When I was six, my parents went down to Oklahoma to visit a friend of my dad's. And I'd never been down there, but they'd been up to Iowa and they were pretty good. And I really liked them and I was very excited. And so we got to their house and I got out of the car and I ran like a bat out of hell because the door was open. Except when I got there, I found out the hard way the door was not open. They just had one of those huge plexiglass doors. And I hit that thing full steam, bounced back. Oh, I always test now. I always.
That's good. You know, speaking of made up things that you're scared of, back to our Batman movie examples. So one point they challenge Batman on what he's most scared of. And they're trying to get to the movie plot point. He's naming things. He's like, snakes? No. Clowns? No. Snake clowns. Yeah, that's it. He invented snake clowns. And that is what Batman is most afraid of. So if you ever wondered what his kryptonite is, it's snake clowns.
Snake clowns. Good to know.
So
good to know. All right, we got a couple minutes left. You wanted to talk a little bit about L.
Oh, I did. I just didn't know. Did you want to get Mark in real quick? Right, because Mark wanted to talk about the gangsters and DLP and Office 365. And
we got plenty of time. Talk about L, and then we'll get Mark in.
Okay, good, good. Yeah. I don't want to miss out on Mark. Yeah, so one of the things I want to talk about for a minute, right, we've talked about it probably a dozen times over the 328 shows that we've done, is the curse of knowledge. Right. And yes. Todd's always been the best one at articulating this, but really the curse of knowledge boils down to is once you learn something, you just can't imagine how everyone else in the world just doesn't understand that. And so with the curse of knowledge, it's one of those things that makes a lot of people really bad at teaching, right, or coaching or that type of stuff, because they just can't think of how would I ever explain to someone, well, you have to right-click on PowerShell and run as administrator. Everyone just knows that. Turns out everyone doesn't just know that.
Yeah, and for me, so Shane yells at me about this all the time. It manifests itself in the way that I assume if I know something, it must be so criminally, trivially obvious that everybody knows it. So I do a bad job explaining things because I just figure, you know, sky's blue, water's wet, and that's how it goes. And so Shane used to, not as bad now, but Shane used to always bust my chops about that. So yeah, it's this idea that you can't imagine not know, you can't imagine what it's like not knowing something once you know it. And it's a very real thing.
Yeah. Well, so, and what brought this all into the forefront for me was my brother-in-law has a water jug fitness, right, where he helps people with meal planning and, you know, meal prep and that type of stuff around nutritional things. And it's mostly around gaining weight, actually, right? It turns out, you know, a little 125-pound scuba that started working with us when he was 21 now weighs 180 pounds and has biceps about this big around.
And not an ounce of fat anywhere on his body.
Yeah, him and Batman have a 9-pack, right? Batman pointed out in the movie that he had 9 abs. He showed the special one. That's how ripped he is. Scuba's kind of the same way.
Yeah.
He's very weak, though. Ask that boy to pick up furniture to move it around. Those muscles are for show, not for go. I kid you not, right? Because he takes all the stuff, and I mean, they're mostly just water, right? He flexes, it does this, but you kind of like, oh, look at the wave. Poor scuba. I'm sorry, scuba.
Poor scuba. Poor scuba. And he puts ice in his coffee, too.
Todd could not handle that morning at Waffle House.
He was sitting right next to me. Somebody might think he was with me or something, putting ice in his coffee. Good God.
But Scuba makes videos around this stuff. He has like 50,000 YouTube subscribers, right? I mean, I know I'm over 1,000.
Oh, for God's sake. Shut up.
But Scuba's like 50,000 subscribers. He actually has a whole business around this stuff. And anyway, this week he made a video around how to make a BLT, right? A bacon, lettuce, tomato sandwich, and kind of understand the macros or the nutritional aspects of that, the protein, the carbs, and the calories and all that. And people out there are just lighting him up like, you're so dumb. Why would you post this? Everyone knows it. And his audience is mostly, well, he has two demographics, but his main demographic is 18 to, you know, 22-year-old males that are, you know, not very smart. And so all the ones that know how to do all these things, they think he's an idiot for showing them how to do it. But there's a lot of people out there, right? They've never made their own BLT. Mom makes my BLT. And so he walks through all the steps, right? Here's your pan. Here's how you fry the bacon. And
yeah.
It's a great concept and it gets him lots of views, but apparently, you know, the people that suffer from the curse of knowledge just can't imagine why everyone doesn't know how to make a BLT.
That and haters gonna hate. Yeah. That's And just so you know, I have 995 subscribers on my channel. So if you out there in internet land and you want to stuff a sock in Shane's mouth, go out to Todd or go to youtube.com/ToddClintNetcast. Subscribe. And let's get that over 1,000.
So let's see. So when I had zero, Todd had 992. I now have 1,354, and Todd now has 995. So
995 quality subscribers. There's not a one of these that I wouldn't sit in a foxhole with and defend to the death. These people are the salt of the earth, all 995 of them. I vouch for every one of them.
Well, see, you have to stop doing that. Once you get over 1,000, you start getting fake accounts joining, so you won't want to vouch for them, you know, in another 6 months or 9 months when you get over 1,000.
I welcome my Russian robot followers.
Yeah, me too. I enjoy every one of them.
All right, so I know you got a house full of people up there. We need to get you moving.
Oh, but Mark.
Oh, son of a... Next week, Mark. Next week we will get you on. I promise next week. Coming up, we got a couple of things. Number one, the training. So go to boldzebras.com, March 20th through the 24th. SharePoint admin training. We're going to cover all the SharePoints, all the onlines. We're going to have hands-on labs, all kinds of fun stuff. And it's what, 3 hours a day? I think, is that what it was? 4 hours a day?
It's like 2.5, right? Because we do an hour and 15-minute section, then we give them an hour for lunch and another hour and 15 minutes. So about 2.5, plus then they do the hands-on labs on their own time, so...
Yep. So that's out there, boldzebras.com. Check that out. We had an email right after we posted that if we would do group discounts. Yeah, we probably would. I don't know what the number is on people or price, but we'll do that. I very generously, the guy emailed me and said, hey, Jeff emailed me and said, can we do group discounts? I said, absolutely. We've got this all figured out. We can give you a discount. It just comes out of Shane's portion. So yeah, we can make that work.
Yeah, I'm working now on programming the progressive name your price tool, and we're going to, you know, be able to zap it up and...
Bam.
I was like, you know, I don't really know Jeff. I hope he doesn't completely think I'm an idiot. Or he does think I'm an idiot.
He does. He absolutely does. Absolutely. Yeah. Him and I have been emailing back and forth without you. And yeah, I have told him all about you.
Okay, good.
And then a couple weeks later, we're going to be at SP TechCon in Austin. So go to sptechcon.com. We're doing a whole bunch of sessions there. Azure AD and PowerShell and all that.
I've got to sign my paperwork for that yet. Have you done it?
I have not. No, I've been signing other paperwork, though. Whew, sign in hand, tired. Oh.
Well, they want you to fax it back, and I know that you you have a fax machine still?
No, but I think my wife does at work. She still has a job, so I think I can have her. Yeah. You know, I could walk down to Kinko's or CopyWorks or something.
They charge money for that.
I can maybe pick up some cans on the way down.
All right.
So get upstairs, say hi to your guests for me. We will see you all next week. Hopefully, you know, I'll put some actual clothes on and these Girl Scout cookies will be gone, hopefully.
Well, the Girl Scout cookies are already gone. Let's be clear. Those are empty boxes. You can recycle those, though. You might be able to get like a penny if you recycle all those boxes.
I could burn them for heat. Maybe I could eat them. I wonder if I mix them.
This is your money-making scheme. You can eat Girl Scout cookies and then sell the boxes for a penny. So buy a box for $3, sell it for a penny.
I think I know how to get those 5 subscribers on YouTube. People on YouTube will watch videos of anything. I think I'll just make videos of me eating Girl Scout cookies.
You know, Lil Sparky and I have been doing puzzles. We've been cranking through the puzzles lately. I've been thinking about maybe putting those on there, right? People probably enjoy watching us do puzzles. And
in all seriousness, I would absolutely do that if I were you. Camera up above, time lapse, I would absolutely do that. Yes.
It's been in the noggin, right? Because, I mean, I am making $3 a day off of YouTube. So maybe that gets me to 4.
I remember the time when you were making less than $1.
I know. Remember I used to do this? Now I can be every day.
I remember you back when.
We will charge you.
That's almost $100 a month. All right. Get out of here. I'll see you next week. Chat room, I'll stick around for a few minutes. But good to see you, everybody. We'll see you next week.
Thanks.